Welcome back. This is Module 3, Lesson 4. In this module, I'm going to introduce shutter speed, which I think is probably the easiest of the three elements of the exposure triangle to grasp for most people, since it's not an unfamiliar term like aperture or ISO. And for most people, it just seems more intuitive. We'll talk about what shutter speed is, how to tell what shutter speed you're using when you look through the viewfinder, and why your choice of shutter speed is so important in getting sharp images. What is shutter speed? Shutter speed is simply the length of time the shutter stays open while you're taking a picture. The longer the shutter stays open, the more light there is that comes in and affects your exposure. The shorter the shutter stays open, the less light there is that passes through the shutter affecting your exposure. So if your shutter were open for, let's say, an entire second, you would have a lot more light affecting your exposure than if you used a quick shutter speed of, let's say, 1/500th of a second. Since 1/500th is just a tiny fraction of a second, the amount of light passing through the shutter is much, much less than what would be coming through during an entire second. That totally makes sense, right? With most cameras, when you look in through the viewfinder, you'll see your current shutter speed at the bottom left, but it will not show the top part of the fraction. So let's say your shutter speed is 1/500th of a second. When you look through the viewfinder, it'll show 500. You won't see the top part of the fraction. Typically though, if you look at the display on the back of your camera, it does show the entire fraction there. I think it just comes down to there being more real estate on the back of the camera to display that information than there is inside the viewfinder. Also, it may be helpful to know that when people refer to their shutter speed, they may say 1/25th or whatever the shutter speed may be. They won't necessarily, in other words, say 1/125th. Many photographers will drop that top part of the fraction when they're talking about a shutter speed. Although most of what I'll call walking around photography uses a shutter speed that's just a fraction of a second, there may be times when you use a shutter speed that is longer than a fraction of a second. In other words, an entire second or longer. In that case, the way it may be written when you look through the viewfinder is you'll see the number followed by a quote mark or an inch sign or whatever you want to call that symbol. Let's say the camera is set to 1/15th of a second. That's 1/15. When you look in the viewfinder, it'll show 15 as your shutter speed. But if instead you had it set to 15 full seconds, then when you look in the shutter speed, you'll see 15 with a quote mark after it. So it'll look like 15 quote. That's how you can tell the difference. A shutter speed of a fraction of a second does not have anything after it, but a shutter speed that is a full second or longer does. It's possible that there's an official name for that quote mark or inch mark or whatever it is, but I honestly don't know what it is. So if anyone happens to know, I'd be happy to have you tell me. Now that we've talked about how to read shutter speed notations, let's talk about why we usually need a fastish shutter speed rather than a slow one. Usually, with most everyday photography, we're trying to achieve a shutter speed that's fast enough to do a couple things. One is to freeze motion, and the other is to prevent blur resulting from camera shake. The goal of both is to enable us to get a sharp, crisp picture. In either case, a shutter speed that is too slow can prevent us from getting that. Out-of-focus photos are absolutely the biggest problem I tend to see with people's pictures. Something I've found is that whenever I explain in class that we need to be able to both freeze our subject and prevent blur from camera shake, the first people usually ask me is, how fast is that? How fast do I need my shutter to be? What is a good, safe shutter speed? The answer to that, though, is there really are a variety of factors that determine how fast that needs to be, and there isn't necessarily a one-size-fits-all shutter speed. One of the factors that determines how fast your shutter needs to be when attempting to freeze motion is how fast your subject is moving. And obviously, different subjects move at different speeds. So if you have someone just sitting in a chair posing for you, for example, you don't probably need as fast of a shutter speed as you would if you have a child playing or a dog running or a car driving by, just to give you a few examples. Sports photography, is a classic situation where a fast shutter speed is important. When you start experimenting, you'll find that different sports require different shutter speeds to capture them. So, for instance, hockey, which is so darn fast, will require a shutter speed around 1/1000th of a second to freeze the motion. With other sports that don't move quite as quickly, you can probably get away with a slower shutter speed and still freeze the motion. And here's an example. I took these pictures because I wanted to be able to show you how something that's moving is going to look at different shutter speeds. So I took my daughter's bike and I turned it upside down on the ground and I started spinning the tire. I had the camera on a tripod and I kept taking different photos at different shutter speeds. So take a look at the first one, which is 1/25th of a second. That's a relatively slow shutter speed given given the speed that the wheel is spinning. So the spokes pretty much vanished in that picture. The camera did not freeze the motion in this case because the shutter opened, the wheel kept spinning, and then the shutter closed, and all that movement was recorded. Then in the next one, 1/60th of a second, that's faster, and you can see that the center part started to show up and not get quite captured or frozen yet. Then 1/160th of a second. Sometimes it's hard to spit out those shutter speeds and have people understand what you're saying. 1/160th of a second was the next speed I used, and you can see how the center of the spokes was pretty much frozen, but there's still some movement in the outer part of the spokes since that part of the tire is traveling faster. Then we get to the last image, which was 1/400th of a second. This shutter speed came a lot closer to freezing the motion, but not completely. But you can see that the center part doesn't look like it's moving at all. If I had then taken another photo at 1/1000th of a second, you would see a bike tire that didn't look like it was even moving at all, even though it was. 1/1000th of a second is fast enough. In other words, it's open for such a short time that it would have completely frozen the wheel's motion. I recommend playing around with your shutter speed with different subjects moving at different speeds to get a good idea of what shutter speed works best in a given situation. Freezing motion is one of the things you need to do to prevent having a blurry picture, and one of the reasons that we usually, in our regular walking around kind of photography, are looking for a fast shutter speed. The second way a fast shutter speed can help us prevent blurry photos is by reducing the effects of camera shake. If you are hand holding your camera, you're going to have camera shake to some degree if your shutter speed is too slow. But if you put it on a tripod, you're most likely going to eliminate camera shake, but even then, not necessarily completely, because you can actually even cause some camera shake just by the movement that is caused by pressing down on the shutter button. So that's why many photographers will use a remote to trigger the camera when it's on a tripod. The faster your shutter speed, the less likely you're going to experience the effects of camera shake in your photo, because at some point, the faster shutter speed is going to overcome that problem. In the next module, I'll give you an exercise where you can test out different shutter speeds and how they affect the effects of camera shake. These days, we're lucky that many newer lenses have a vibration reduction, or what they call image stabilization feature, that helps prevent the effects of camera shake, enabling you to handle your camera at slower shutter speeds than you would be able to otherwise. With a lens that doesn't have image stabilization or vibration reduction, a situation may require to use, let's say, 1/60th of a second to prevent shake. But with an image stabilization or vibration reduction lens, you might be able to get away with 1/30th of a second or something like that. Still, it doesn't completely eliminate the need to keep your shutter speed up and try to keep from moving your camera too much while taking a picture. It's hard to recommend an exact shutter speed that you need to use in order to prevent the effects of camera shake. One reason for that is that different lengths of lenses have different requirements. There is an old and somewhat outdated rule of thumb that says that your shutter speed should be the reciprocal of the length of your lens. And you might be thinking, wait, what does that mean? So let's say you're using a 50 millimeter length lens. This rule would have said that your shutter speed needs to be 1/50th of a second. If you were using a lens that was zoomed in to 200, the shutter speed you need to use is 1/200th. I've heard different versions of this rule also, that it should be the reciprocal of the length of your lens, or that it should be twice the reciprocal. The reason, though, that I say that this rule is a little outdated is because of the fact that when the rule was created, we didn't have vibration reduction lenses, which allow you to handhold at slower shutter speeds. Regardless, it's good to keep in mind, especially for those of you working with lenses that don't have vibration reduction. The biggest takeaway, I think, from this rule is that longer lenses require a faster shutter speed in order to prevent problems from camera shake. If you're using a lens zoomed all the way into 300, then you really need to be holding it pretty darn steady or probably using a tripod. Another thing I'll mention is that while you're taking a photo, if you can hear that shutter open and close, then you're probably at too slow of a shutter speed to handhold your camera. That would be when you take a picture and you hear this click, click, the start and the stop when the shutter opens and closes. Too slow. That's when you need to figure out a way to get your shutter speed up, either that or get it on a tripod. If you just hear one slide click, then you're in faster range and you're probably in a better situation to handhold. To wrap up this lesson, I don't want to beat a dead horse, but I do want to reiterate that there are two reasons that in normal, everyday photography, when you're walking around carrying your camera and hand-holding, there are two reasons why we're usually going for a fast-ish shutter speed. One is to reduce blur from camera shake, and the other is to reduce blur by freezing the motion of a moving subject. But that does not mean that you always want to have a fast shutter speed. There are plenty of times when you might want to have a slower shutter speed. Instead of freezing motion, you may actually want to slow and show the motion. We'll talk about that in the next lesson. See you there. If you found this video helpful, hit like, subscribe to my channel, and ring the bell to be sure you get my new videos as they're released. I'd also love it if you would enter your biggest takeaways in the comments. This video is just a small part of my entire DSLR Savvy course, so I hope you'll check out the other videos as well. If you're curious as to which equipment I use, you can find that info in the video description. Thanks for watching.